Pereyo Bailana, I come from Shefa, based in our regional office in Singapore. What I'm going to do the next 40 minutes, try to give you some ideas of what is actually happening out there in terms of technology in the distribution center. Yeah, so I'll try to keep it very simple. We as a company, we supply storage system from very basic racking and shelving, which is still our bread and butter. We also have moved now into automation. So we have seen over the last 2 years automation actually coming to Asia in many countries at different levels, especially in China and Singapore at the moment. All the high-end projects are being built in Singapore and China. Okay, the agenda, briefly on the evolution of the logistics system, what is happening out there. What we see are the market trends in Asia-Pacific region, what we see as projects coming to us in the region, what is being built, or what is going to be built in the next 5 years. Order fulfillment technology, how we go about to design a distribution center, and it can actually be paid for, the ROI. And then some case studies. Technology-wise, there is nothing new. Started many years ago with some boxes and shelves, and then moving into racking, palletized goods, picking, technology conveyors, and until what we have nowadays, the high-end automation systems, especially to do with the e-commerce. I just put this slide because I think it's interesting, just to demonstrate what is actually happening, what we see in the region. This is for food and beverage. I mean, when we go and buy a supermarket, if you take Pepsi Cola or Coca Cola, I don't know whether there's anybody here from Pepsi or Coke or maybe F&N, there is a whole range of products you can buy from them already. Yeah? I think Coca Cola is running into 150 SKUs already in Malaysia, maybe the same for Pepsi. F&N, they probably have more. 10 years ago, they only had 50. Yeah? So that happens to make some impacts when it comes to the warehouse operation. We, as a customers, are we getting very picky what we buy. You know? So, what is happening? A lot of SKUs that you have to keep in your warehouses. Yeah? A lot more than we have to be in the past. Order size, e-commerce, they have thousands of orders every day. They have to pick, but every pick is only one piece. But you have to send one guy to pick that piece and come back and send. Yeah? So that has some implications in the warehouse design. Service levels expectation, and so on and so forth. So what it means for the warehouse distribution center, we need to have, or need to design some flexibility into the systems we put there. So we are able to supply the level of requirements we have, we're able to face the execution, implementation, and investment. E-commerce business now is growing so fast. We are doing some projects in China. They are already currently having a million SKUs in the warehouse. You know, how to handle that? What are they going to have in 5 years from now? Maybe next year, maybe 1.5 million SKUs. How to handle that? You have to create location. You have to get somebody to pick those SKUs. So this is very challenging. Sorry. I apologize. Okay. Okay, we are here. Product life. Everything moves a lot faster. Whatever you buy today in the supermarket, you go tomorrow, maybe it's no longer there, it's a different product. Phones, for example, how often they change the model. Everything is just moving a lot faster. The shelf life is getting shorter and shorter. So that has some implications in the warehouse. Order processing speed, the black arrow is supposed to be red in my screen here, that means e-commerce. So that is important for e-commerce business, the speed, how you process the order. How long does it take for you to process the order? Returns is big cost at the moment in many of the operations. What is coming back to the warehouse, which has been wrongly picked or sent wrongly to the wrong customer. Yeah, so how do you handle that? E-commerce at the moment they are handling something between 20, 30, 40, up to 70% returns in some business, especially in fashion logistics. There is someone from fashion logistics here, they have up to 70%. And that's a lot to handle. For retail, for example, sending the goods to a store in Europe, you have to send the goods in palletized, for example, in a manner that when you enter the store, this pallet goes into this aisle, this pallet goes into this aisle. And not only that, what's on top of the pallet is the case or the pallet you have to pick and put in the high-level shelf. Yeah? So it's store friendly. So the delivery is a lot faster. How do you do that at the warehouse? Ergonomics, productivity, how do you reduce or how you make your people more efficient? Talking to order lines, how many order lines you pick per person and so on and so forth, but ergonomics. In Europe, there, in Scandinavia, they have a law that says that the guy who works at the warehouse, the picker, is only allowed by law to pick 2.5 tons per day, least. So, in Asia, if every box is 25 kilos, after he picks 100 cases, he goes home. So how do you handle that? Yeah? Manually, not possible anymore. So you need to put some technology in place that allows people to work 8 hours within the limits of 2.5 tons of lifting goods. So, and then we have B2B, B2C, C2C, C2B, whatever. Yeah? Especially the B2C is now the e-commerce is hot out there and happening. So, market trends in Asia, this is nothing new. Number of SKUs, size of the orders. So you have direct to consumer, that means e-commerce, for example, online business, you have a lot of orders every day and a lot of SKUs, very complex. And then you have a simple distribution, the F&B guys, Coca-Cola, Pepsi, F&N here in Malaysia. Everything is palletized, goes to the distribution centers. So, very limited number of SKUs, but large volumes. So, in the warehouse, this is happening. A lot of small picking here. We have mixed pallet picking for distribution, and then you have full pallet. How you handle this is a challenge. Yeah? And then we have the 3PLs, many of you are here, they want to do everything and they're doing everything actually. So to them, it's a big challenge to do all these things within the same distribution center. It's a massive task. So for us, what we see in the region happening is a lot of, you cannot see it here because it's the projector problem, but this one is e-commerce, growing very fast. This is what we see, especially in China. I'll show you later a case for China. They are picking 1 million pieces a day. Out from one distribution center, 1 million pieces a day. This one here is pharma and cosmetics, also moving fast in some specific countries, especially Thailand and Korea. Retail business is across the region everywhere, but not so much in China because nobody buys from the shopping mall anymore. Right? Everybody goes to the shopping mall to see what you want to buy, go home, buy online e-commerce. So a lot of business in China from retail is moving here. And I think it's going to happen in Singapore and Malaysia very soon, probably. I do the same. Like, I don't buy anything on the shopping mall. I just go and have a look, and then I buy from home. It's actually cheaper. The other one is here, cold storage. Food processing, seafood, frozen food distribution is moving very fast at the moment, especially in Singapore, Malaysia, and Thailand. Thailand and Vietnam as well. They are big exporters for frozen seafood and frozen meat like chicken. India is also growing very fast at this. And the last one is F&B. Coca-Cola, Pepsi-Cola, all the guys doing drinks. So, with all of this, how do we go about it? Design the warehouse to make the order fulfillment to happen. So, for us, very important to get some data. Well, what is happening? Historical data. In the past, nobody had information, but nowadays, most of the companies we talk, they actually have information from the ERPs. So we can track down the last year operation, what is moving, what is not moving, what are the volumes. So we can design the solution, or the concept, or the project, according to the fast movers and the slow movers. In the end, what we want to know is this. You take any simple warehouse operation, what we want to know what is going in and what is going out. But more specifically, how it is going on, because this is very important how we actually design the facility itself. So what's inside? That's our job. Yeah. So we're looking to receiving, storage, picking, and delivery. So what's conventional racking, palletized goods, but then we have the automation. Yeah, this is already here to stay in many countries. We have there is a number of projects in Singapore, not only built by us, but the industry suppliers, as well, a lot of them. They are in Thailand, they are in Vietnam, they are here in Malaysia also, they are in India, they are in China. This is already here for a number of years already. Yeah, but still, this is what is mostly out there. 80% of the facility is very much conventional. Still now. Then you have case picking operations. We call it person to goods, means I go and pick something and put it back to the distribution, to the delivery. Yeah, we call it food spread. So you have case picking, manually pick, guy going around, like a supermarket shopping, same thing. You can improve the picking rate. This guy will probably pick with a picking list 30, 40, 50 cases, depending on the number of SKUs you have per hour. If you put a conveyor, they will pick probably up to 100, 150, yeah? Because they do zone picking. So by improving a little bit, putting some technology investment, you can easily double or triple the performance of one picker. Then you're gonna go automation for case picking is also available. Simple, this probably most of you know, it's a mini lot system that you put the case, it goes away with a crane, it comes back, you pick and you put another one. So this is automated, but this is new. This is already a number of projects already built. There is no racking storage anymore. There is no palletized goods. Whatever goes into the warehouse goes inside as a case and case, a single unit of cases. Goes in, this is depalletized, goes in, gets picked by the machine, comes out, and we deliver the orders for every single store, for example. Yeah, it's case picking, nobody works on that. Depalletized, robots, palletized again, if you have to palletize for delivery, mixed pallets, it's a robot doing. This is already built in Australia, in Europe, built into now in the USA for Walmart. This is the latest we have, this is out there in the market. Nobody doing picking the equipment. Obviously, it's a very big investment. So, coming back to here, this is what we have for piece picking, mostly, most of us, we have some shelving, and we send the people around doing supermarket shelving, like a supermarket with a trolley, we pick. So, yeah, I'm the picker, I will pick probably 40 to 50 pieces per hour in the supermarket with a trolley. You put some conveyors in, you do zone picking, means the picker only takes care of these few aisles, small walking distance, she knows quite exactly where all the locations are. And pick to a tote, the tote travels around the warehouse, plastic box, yeah, that's the order. So with this, you can increase from 50 maybe to 150, three times faster, with the same number of people, just investing some conveyor, some technology, maybe with RF, maybe with voice picking. Same thing, person to goods, they still, they send the people to pick with a carton life storage, zone picking, one arm, the picker only moves 10 meters up and down using pick by line. She can pick around 300 using this. So remember, from 15 up to 300, this is how many people you can actually save, or how fast you can grow with the current people you have now. Yeah? By only putting some conveying system and some picking technology. The investment is not big. Same for piece picking, still person to goods, the people go to pick the goods. Same thing, case picking, small picking, using bots. Some of you already have here in Malaysia voice picking, and it's working very fine. So the picking rations can range between 80 to 150 per hour, yeah, which is a lot better than what we have. But also you need to take into consideration the accuracy, because you actually follow the instruction from the computer to pick the correct location, the correct quantity. You can add to that, like this picker here, she goes around with a trolley. In the trolley she has 4 8 boxes, so she's picking different orders into different 8 boxes. And she's using, you can see, voice picking, but she's got a barcode scanner in the finger. So Every time she picks something, she scans. So you have almost 100% accuracy what she's picking into. Yeah. So she's probably picking 100, 150 pieces per hour. You can see still a lot of shoving, a trolley, little conveyor, and some technology for picking. If you want to go higher, well, the movie is a bit big, so the computer is a bit small. Okay, now. Again, piece picking, but person, goods to person. So we don't send the people to pick. The goods come into the picker. The picker stays in one place, it doesn't go anywhere, stays put. And the goods are coming. So you can see the picker there, and the goods are coming into the picker through the conveyor, picked from one box, which is a stock, and put into another box, which is the order goes away. With this equipment, one person can pick around 1,000 pieces per hour. Yeah? So you can see, I just put the video again. So what is this, what is happening? The investment is at the back. The equipment, the automation fulfills what has to be picked. Yeah? So all the stocks is inside these boxes. So 1,000, one person. The person doesn't go anywhere. Yeah? So they have a light here, the light tells the picker how many pieces to pick and from which box into which box. So it's picking from a stock to an order. Yeah, so it's very fast and very accurate. Now, some examples. So I will start from very basic investment to the high level automation. Because this is what we see happening, for example, in Singapore, because the cost of the running operation is a lot higher than it is, for example, in Thailand or Vietnam or even Malaysia. The ROI can be justified with higher technology. Same in China. Actually, China, I think somebody mentioned earlier today that doing business in China is no longer cheap. Yeah, it is true. It's actually very expensive. But that is one. The people are not expensive anymore. But the cost of getting people to come to you and to stay with you is even costlier. And there is no people in China anymore to work. Everybody is doing something else. I don't know, 1.2 billion people there. Problem, huh? Good problem for us. We got some business. So this is a small online mail order company. They are growing. Online means e-commerce. They are very dedicated to a range of products. They don't have too many SKUs, but they are growing very fast. So what they wanted, something that can be implemented within 5-6 months and low investment, and actually can actually be scalable next time. So current situation, it was like this, typical. Yeah. Only 5,000 square meters, 12,000 SKUs and growing. Low picking performance, probably they were picking 40, 50 per hour, per person, and returns and accuracy. If you don't have accuracy, you have returns. So what we did is look into that, I will skip this. What we did is always the same. We go zone picking, yeah, to make people work faster. So instead of sending people shopping around, we say you stay here, you pick from this place to this place. 100 SKUs so we can pick faster. So what you need to do is to get the order to travel around. So they have to pick and put into the order goes with a box to the next picking location until the end. Yeah, so we look at the this. So I'm not going to go through because I want to show you a quick video, which is better. So we designed the system around what needs to happen. Order starts, fast movers, slow movers, replenishment from the racking or shelving, packing and go. Yeah. So what's happening is the people are not moving, the order is moving. Yeah. So you can see, you can take it as 34 reduction, but you can also take it as 34%, you can increase your business in the next 2 years with the same people you have. Yeah. So we have a small conveyor, we call it a cruiser. It just travels around. So these people, they pick into carton boxes already. This carton goes to the market later. So it just travels around, and when it stops there, the picker have RF, shoots at the box, she knows what to pick, she picks, put into the box, and the box travels around. So the solution is a lot of shelving, a lot of carton life storage, and some vertical lift to make sure that we utilize the height. Yeah? So, okay, 5 minutes. So you can see the key is to not to get people to go anywhere because they get lost. They go small, they go WhatsApp, they go Facebook and everything. So another one similar for medicines. This is only 1,000 SKUs. Small, very simple maybe, but look at this. They had 1.2 times speed on Mondays. Yeah? 6,000 other lines a day, but on Mondays they have 12,000, whichever reason. So they had a problem. You cannot get on Monday to have to double the people you have on last Friday to come just for Monday, right? So same issue, we come up with a solution for them. Again, very simple, racking and shelving, and we get the order to travel around with a small conveyor. So start the order here, we pick into the top, and the top travels around. Slow movers at the last, fast movers, big movers, last movers. So again, I'll skip this, I'll show you the video, which is more interesting. So in this case, technology, racking, shelving, conveyor, boxes to pick to, and pick by that, sorry, pick by voice, and RF scanner. This customer in particular, he wanted to scan every single item they pick, every single, because expensive stuff. They want to make sure that everything goes out is the correct one. Yeah, so you can see the pictures, people wearing the headset, the conveyors, and the video. Video. Video not working. Now it's moving. Actually move all the time. Huh? So the box doesn't go anywhere, just stay within the warehouse. You can see it's got a label, we call it license plate. So we start the order. We marry the order with a box, or 2 boxes, or 3 boxes, depending on the volume. The system assigns that automatically. So when he comes to a picking station, he scans, now he knows what to pick. He only takes care of 3 bays. So you can see he's picking, he's scanning, putting in a pocket, because every order line may be 2-3 pieces. And then he puts in the correct box. When he's finished, he pushes the box into the middle conveyor, and the box goes to the next picking station. They are picking about 250-280. Per hour average in this warehouse now. So you can see it's actually simple. Yeah? So they needed to pick within 90 minutes everything. So again, I think the customer in the end wanted to have a next six months implementation, so you cannot go very high technology, but also they have ROI, maximum 1.3 million euros in this case, so done. Book distribution for books, 3PL businesses, B2B and B2C, low investment option for low or medium personal cost. So this one is already built. You can see what we have built is a lot of racking and shelving, again very simple, but we have given them some technology, which is conveyor, pick to tote, but also automated machines that erect the totes. So they are picking into system totes, plastic totes, but they're also picking into carton boxes that they go out. So there is a machine that erects the box by itself. 40,000 different SKUs. So you can see here, I highlighted how much they do every day. How much is palletized, how much is case picking, how much is piece picking. Yeah, there's always a trouble with these two. Yeah. Okay, 1 minute go. So the solution is a combination of shelving and conveyor system. In some pictures, you can see here the order starts automatically. It's a tot dispenser machine, automatically marries the order with the box, and then another one erects the carton. So because the business is different, this is B2C, this is B2B. For the schools and so on, the volumes are bigger. So for the carton boxes, actually we label them and they go. Also, we marry the order with a carton box, same thing. So it just travels around and the pickers, they pick into the boxes. We have two different areas, one which is for the sea movers, the small picks, the other area is for the case picking, bigger volumes. So in the end, it's just a big measuring system with conveyors. This one is in Singapore. Yeah, so very nice. Yeah, so I have 1 minute left or less. So this one, Just met someone here in fashion logistics. This is an interesting one. This is coming here in China, big time. This is in Europe. Now, e-commerce for fashion. They sell or they distribute flat goods, t-shirts and everything, garments as well, and also shoes and boxes and so on. So I just skip this one. I just go to the movie. So they have two storage systems, one for the flat packs, the other one for the garments, because it's totally different. You cannot mix them unless you don't hang them. Yeah, but you have to hang them. So I'll skip this and go into the video. This is very interesting again because it's not fully automatic warehouse. It's not a big investment. It's again a lot of racking and shelving, and we just put the conveyors. For the flat goods, it's normal conveyor. The flat goods go into a box, in and out, and the garments, we have a hanging garment conveyor. Probably you've seen before. So this is receiving area. They are receiving, they are checking and scanning, everything comes in, QA and everything, and then they put away. So they have the black boxes, is for replenishment, so they're putting things away into the storage locations. This is shoes. They handle the returns the same way. Yeah, whatever comes in, they scan, they check whether they can actually be resold, they can put back to stock, or they have to do something else with it. Yeah? So the conveyor takes the goods up to the correct levels of locations. You can see this travels up by conveyor. You can see some receiving of garments already. This is the flat goods area. So the picker is just taking away and replenishing in all the locations. Yeah. So simple, rack shelving and carton boxes for the locations. Very simple, not a big investment. But they have RF. Everything is barcoded. Yeah. So she's now she's doing this. The same person is doing picking at the same time. Yeah. So if you receive a box to pick something, she scans the box, she doesn't have to pick something, goes and pick, put into the box. So you can see mix of green color, to be red, this is red actually, red color and black. Red is orders, black is replenishment. So he's doing it at the same time. So you can see she's only moving in one or two hours up and down. So I'm picking again. So she's probably picking 200-250 per hour. Garments, totally different operation because the requirements, when they receive, they hang into the conveyor and the system takes it into a machine. We have to be clean, but it's not cleaning. You will see the machine, it's just vaporizing and taking the dust away before they pack. Because before they put into storage, they have to pack them. So this is a machine, just takes the dust away from the transportation, if any. And then we going through the bagging machine, put a plastic bag into it here, now. And then goes into storage. Yeah. So the replenishment and picking happen the same way. The storage system up there, you will see, is also a 3D mezzanine. It's shelving with hangers, and then the replenishment and picking is the same with RF. Yeah. So this travels by itself to the correct levels. So the picker up there just put it away. And the end for dispatch, we have an area where the conveyor does the sequencing per orders. Yeah. So she's now replenishing, she's putting away. So everything is level, you can see. So she scans and she knows where to put it to and she puts it away. You can see the storage system is very different. Yeah. Here in Malaysia, Robinson's using it like this. Without the conveyors. Very manual, but the actual solution is the same. I mean. Okay, so that's on that one. Then maybe something different because the size of it, e-commerce is very hot nowadays. This guy is in China being built now. 1 million SKUs, 1.1 million pieces a day they have to pick. So what they have is from electronics to cosmetics to garments to everything. They actually sell everything, even washing machines. So So this is a facility, 500 by 200 meters. What they have is everything we have, they have. So big one, fully automated, but yet they have 500 people working in this site. This is in China, in Nanjing. Huge, but fully automated, but quite a bit still shoving and dragging. But the technology is there. So everything we have, they actually have in this facility. They pick 1 million pieces a day. So just to put your perspective, to pick 1 million pieces a day, one guy picks one piece, it's e-commerce, one order, one piece, one book, one CD, whatever you buy. You have to send this guy a million times to pick something every day. This is huge. So that's all I have. Thank you very much.
Any questions from the floor in Q&A? One question in here, we have a mic.
Yep.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ivan Chua. I'm from ABL Logistics. My question about the goods to people technology. It appears to be a heavy investment, right? I wanted to ask, what will be the payback period? And people like the 3PL, right, typically we have a contract of not more than 3 years or maximum 5 years. How could we justify this sort of investment for our customer?
Difficult. Okay, I'll give you a few options. Option number one, you make sure you get a longer contract with your customer. From 3 years, maybe to 5 years. Second question is about the ROI. I mean, everybody, different companies have different policies about ROI and investment. But normally everybody looking at less than 3 years. And that's exactly the problem that 3PL have, because normally in Asia, most of the contracts are only 3 years. So the question is, you invest so much into something like this, and then 3 years you lose your customer. So my answer to you, don't lose your customer, actually he renews for another 3 years. Okay, but that's a reality, we know about that. But having said that, we're actually building some of these in Singapore for 3PLs. Yeah, the book distribution is a 3PL company, actually. So I don't know how long is the contract they have. We were not involved in the ROI calculation. We provide the concept, the solution, and the investment. They did the ROI themselves. So I don't know how they did it. But book distribution in Singapore, these guys, they have been doing the book distribution for the last 15 years. So chances are they will keep on doing it, they will not lose the customer. So in the end, it's down to you as a company, how confident you are that you will not lose the customer. But in Singapore, as it was mentioned earlier also by someone, I'm coming from Singapore, we have a big problem with people because the government has closed the town for foreign workers at all levels. So there is a quota. So if you have a warehouse with 30 people now doing picking and you're asking to your business double in 2 years, you want 30 more people, you're not going to get it. That's the only solution. It's not whether you keep the customers or not, whether you can actually run the business today with the people you have. So that, how to put a dollar value to calculate the ROI for that, that's a difficult one. But you know, that's the scenario, whether you keep on doing the business or you lose the business altogether. That's the challenge at the moment. Same thing in China, people.
I don't think you're going to get your discount either, unfortunately. Any other questions? No? Thank you very much. I really appreciate it.
Thank you very much.